Hi, I'm Chef Costa Magoulas, and on this episode of Local Flavor, we're cooking my favorites from the Florida backcountry, so stay tuned. Welcome to Local Flavor, and once again, I'm Chef Costa Magoulas. In this episode, we're cooking marsh hens. That's right, marsh hens. Joining me tonight is an avid outdoorsman and hunter, Trevor Luce. Trevor, thanks for coming, and thank you for furnishing us with these marsh hens.
Well, thank you for having me.
Now, you gotta tell me about this. A lot of people say, what's a marsh hen, you know?
Well, it's actually a bird. It's called a clapper rail, and it lives in the marshes. It's widely known in South Carolina and Georgia. And some of the few old-timers in North Florida know about it really well. And it's a bird we hunt in the marshes, generally north of Matanzas, where the water floods really good in the fall, where we have big flood tides.
We want to remind everyone, don't forget, this is a call-in show. So we want you to call in at 1-800-901-9238. Get your pencil and paper. Come on now, 1-800-901-9238. And call us about your questions about hunting marsh hens, and we'll be happy to answer them, okay? Well, we're looking down here, we brought in marsh hens, and I'm gonna show you a little bit about it. And this is one right here. And we need to know how you go hunting these. Tell me about that.
Well, like I said earlier, when the flood tides come in really high, it pushes the water up in the marshes and allows the bird not to be able to run and hide. It makes them actually fly. And as you'll see in a little bit, as we're walking, we'll actually flush the birds and get a sporting shot in the air.
And this is where you were hunting at, right here?
Yes, this is just an area just north of St. Augustine.
Well, that's pretty country over there.
Oh, it's beautiful.
There you are. That's really, let me ask you something. Is there a season on marsh hens?
Yeah, marsh hens actually starts really early, September 1st.
Really?
This is one of the few waterfowls that we can hunt very early in the year, and there's a very liberal bag limit. You can actually have 15 a day.
You're kidding.
It's something you can do and have a lot of fun with.
I've gone duck hunting. I used to love the duck hunt, and I'd see these birds all the time, but you know, I never really thought about hunting them that much. But I didn't realize you could bag 15. Holy goodness. You know, they got a real nice breast on them, too, real nice meat. Oh, look at that country. Is there good fishing there?
There is good fishing there. One of the other things we do is this time of year when the flood tides come in, the redfish and the sheephead and other fish will actually come in to eat the fiddler crabs that the water actually covers on some of the flats that don't normally get water on that time of year.
I really love that countryside. You know, this is Florida. People don't realize it, isn't it?
Yeah, it's some of the best parts of Florida.
How long have you been hunting? I mean, you just grew up in it?
Grew up in it. My grandfather, from a very, very early age, had me out in the field and pretty much we hunted everything we could.
Well,
fish
fancy.
As well.
Uh-oh, there he is. He's getting out the equipment. Now, you're using a shotgun, is that correct?
Correct. And with marsh hens, you can use any type of shotgun, but generally a 20-gauge or smaller is perfect for these birds. They flush and they fly really really well and slow, and it's actually a great bird to start kids out on. They don't fly as fast as some of the ducks and other waterfowl.
Yeah, I noticed they sort of kind of keep close to the water, don't they?
Yep.
That's amazing. Now, you can use any kind of shot for these?
Yeah, you can use actually lead shot. As far as the migratory birds go, with ducks and things, you're going to use a non-toxic steel shot. But with snipe and clapper rails, marsh hens, you can actually use lead shot. So it's actually a very economical bird to hunt.
Well, folks, just remember, we're talking about marsh hens. But we also have some things for those people that don't have friends that are hunters that could get them marsh hens. We're gonna be dealing with a duck here that's very similar to that duck breast, and we have a little Cornish game hen. So if you can't get a hunter to go get you some marsh hen, at least you can go to the store and pick up some of these, okay? But this marsh hen we have right here, isn't that beautiful? I can't get over that. It's just like a little miniature duck. Now the skin is red. A lot of people don't realize why it's red. You know, game animals, you take any kind of game animal, the meat is red because of the oxygen. They do a lot of running and they're very active, so that brings a lot of blood to their muscles throughout their system. So their meats are generally red. It's like dark meat of chicken. And so what you have to do sometimes is to compensate for that flavor, because that has more of an intense flavor sometimes. That's why we're using the buttermilk. We were talking about that earlier.
That's right.
That you like buttermilk as well. I really do. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take this marsh hen and I'm gonna bread it, and very simple breading. Now you can use your own special breading. I just go to the store and I pick up something I really like. You know, you may have some kind of special breading. And then just bread it up real good. I've got my little stove over here cranked up. Everybody calls me up about my special stove. Well, this thing really flies. And I'm using, somebody asked me oil, what kind of oil I was using. It's canola and olive oil blend. That's my favorite. I couldn't find it last week. I was cooking something, so I had it hidden under the table here. So we're gonna wait till that gets nice and hot. I'm using my favorite bag for breading. I love breading in the bag like that. What do you think? Don't forget, folks, this is a call-in show, 1-800-901-9238. You must have some questions about hunting, don't you? You know, I'm just laughing about that because a lot of people, you know, not into hunting, but they don't realize how good that meat really is.
It really is.
I mean, it's really, I love, to me, venison is almost like lamb. It's real, it's not that strong. One of my favorites is elk. I understand you went elk hunting.
Yeah, I just got back from Wyoming last week.
Oh, man, you're killing me. Did you really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's fantastic. How was that out there?
It was beautiful. We were actually able to get a bull, and very, very fortunate and very lucky this year.
Oh, I did a competition one time, and I used elk tenderloin, and it took first place, and people kept asking me, what is that? And I wouldn't tell them. I said, it's elk. I'm not going to eat elk. Yes, you are, I guarantee you. Now, you want to test to see if this is hot. You actually just put your hand over the top of it, and you feel the heat, you know it's pretty hot. I didn't crack this up all the way. Now I did. Oops, I can feel it now. I love this breading technique. You bread it, put it away, and there it is. Now we're going to start frying. Don't forget our number is 1-800. It wasn't quite hot enough, but it's going to be. And I'm going to take this Cornish game hen, and it's, you know, in case you have one at home, you don't have a marsh hen, you can cut this puppy up too, like I did. I know that looks easy, doesn't it? But it is easy. It's not that hard. Now you got a little miniature marsh hen. I have the little back here. There's a little leg. So you can do your own little marsh hen at home. Just go buy a Cornish game hen. There it is, almost done. Take this back here, split it. Come on down to the studio. We'll give you knife lessons. It's no problem. We'll just add that. Just come on down. Now we got to clean this all up and be ready. It's starting to fry now. That's good. What I'm going to do is also fry up some of this Cornish game hen as well, so we can get ready to go to the kitchen in a few minutes. Any calls, don't forget, 1-800-901-9238. Trevor, tell me something. How long have you been hunting? Is from a childhood? Is
very, very early on. Some of my first memories are of being out in the field with my grandfather, like I said earlier.
I got to ask you something. Being in Florida, you know, how many gators have you seen?
Well, we've killed quite a few over the years. We do that as well. And there's actually a lot of alligators in Florida.
Gator meat's great.
It is
very good.
I really
like it. We're thinking about down the road maybe doing a gator show, so I never know. Well, I've got this cooking away for us right now, and I got to put some gloves on because this is poultry and I don't want to contaminate anything else. And I'm going to get rid of this cutting board. I'm going to put that somewhere else. Okay, we're going to get ready to go to the kitchen so that we give you an idea how we make this game hen. Marsh hen. And we're in the kitchen right now. We're going to do roasted vegetables and marsh hen. So most people fry it like we're doing here, but I thought we'd do something a little bit different to give it a little bit more flavor. And so there's your marsh hen. I was marinating it in the buttermilk. And Trevor, you'd like that, right?
Absolutely.
I do that for fried chicken and everything. Clean up my mess. Now, I take the excess buttermilk off. Now, here's all the vegetables that I added with it. You know what? You could take any vegetable that's in season and put in there. You could use zucchini, yellow squash, whatever's in season. I have carrots there, I have celery and onions and a little garlic. I take the marsh hen and I cut it up in a little piece, like a little tiny drumstick. That's just one bite drumstick, isn't it?
It's really good though.
Yeah, it really is. You know, a lot of people just use the breast, but I like the whole bird myself. But I cut it up and I add it to the vegetables, and then I start adding the ingredients as far as the spices that I'm gonna use. Now, one of the secrets to the spice, I also use fresh fruit, any fruit that's in season or dry fruit. And what I like to do a lot of times is, instead of mixing up all my spices, which you're gonna see the recipes on that, is I like to use pickling spice. Pickling spice has everything already in it. So it has the bay leaf, the juniper, it has, and it's really great for a crab boil as well. And I put the butter in there, and then I have to go get that secret ingredient. I have my secret ingredient, and that's wine. Have to add a little bit of wine to this, maybe a little bit more. That actually will add some moisture to it, and it'll reduce down. There won't be any alcohol because it cooks off. We're gonna place this over here. Now, when you're dealing with these products, it's best to use fresh. This is fresh thyme, and that's really a nice product. Rosemary, in fact, we're gonna use a little bit of this fresh rosemary and put that in there as well. Hey, you can smell it. Can y'all smell that rosemary from there? Now we have all the ingredients in here. So we're gonna mix it up. We're gonna mix this up real well. Look at that red meat in there. That's really in the cherries and everything. And of course, the last product, salt. Don't forget what we were talking about in our last show. Use that kosher salt, real good quality salt. And we're ready to put this in the oven. So I'm gonna stick it in our magic oven. 30 minutes later, we have our mud hen. Ooh, that's hot. Doesn't that look beautiful? It's all roasted, caramelized. Well, I can smell that. Can y'all smell this? Now, there's one dish I think that goes with this real well, and that's swamp cabbage. We're dealing with hens. Let's deal with swamp cabbage. So, put this on the side, and let me get my pot here. Now what I have in this pot is a little bit of chicken stock, and I put baking in it. Now for those of you that don't want pork or bacon, you don't have to put bacon in it. Okay, you can just put the chicken stock, but you gotta have the swamp cabbage. Swamp cabbage is really the root of the sable palm. Now you could go out in the woods, cut down a sable palm and cut the heart out, but that's against law here in Florida because that's a state tree. So we bought some commercially. Now what you do is just cut them up. Real simple, and if you see when you cut it, it's kind of coarse. I'm gonna add this to a pot, which I have chicken stock boiling and a little bit of bacon. I'm gonna take everything in here. I took a small onion and I cut it up. You know, onion adds a lot of flavor to everything. So we're gonna add the, there it is. That was pretty simple. Bring it back to a boil. I like to use Savoy cabbage. Now it's very similar in texture to the swamp cabbage. It's an Asian type cabbage. See how it looks real fibrous and everything? Real tasty and sweet. If I need to add a little bit more body to this, all I have to do is just cut a little bit, almost like coleslaw. Now it's done. And now we just have to wait about 5 or 10 minutes for that to cook. And there's your swamp cabbage and your marsh hen. Swamp cabbage right here. And we have the marsh hen that we cooked with our vegetables. We roasted it and everything. So you saw that part of it. But this swamp cabbage is something we really enjoy. Swamp cabbage, you'll see the recipe on our Facebook page. And I believe we're gonna show it to you. It's very simple recipe. It's got a little savory cabbage. And this is, of course, and there's the recipe card. And you see, it's very simple ingredients. There's not a lot to it. It really isn't. It's cabbage and then, of course, salt and pepper. And I use a little chicken stock in that. It's really good. But this is what it looks like right here. And Trevor, you want to give that a little taste? Tell me if you like that or not. Can't eat the whole thing now.
Oh, I want to.
That tastes pretty good.
It's very good.
Good, good, good. Now we've got that marsh hen. Look at this thing over here. Isn't this beautiful? Woo! Don't forget 1-800-901-9238. Come on, folks, give me a call. I feel lonesome over here. I said that, and right away we got a phone call, right, from Daytona Beach. What's your question, Jim?
Yeah, hi. I was just in Sheriff down in Broward County, Florida, and I wanted to ask Trevor if you ever had any smoked gator tail. I used to get a lot of those.
Smoked gator tail? Have you ever had smoked gator tail?
I have. It's really good.
Oh, tell me about that.
Yes, most people think.
I used to smoke a lot of those down there in Broward County, Florida, and you have to the hunters on there. And when they were about 6 feet in length, we would let them go back into the Everglades and report it all after 6 feet.
You wait till they got bigger than 6 feet and let them go back into the Everglades.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that's
and,
pretty neat.
What we would do is then they would just go near to the Indian reservations, and I tasted a lot of smoked gator tails. But a lot of times when you go to restaurants down South Florida, a lot of them are battered. They taste really dry.
Yeah, they can. They really can.
Well, yeah, that's right. If you smoke them, put like a hot sauce, sriracha sauce on it, some blue cheese, fantastic.
Sriracha sauce. I love the sauce.
It's a secret sauce.
I was just going to say, this is the sauce I was going to put on the morning.
My son puts it on everything.
Thank you for your call. I appreciate it. We have another call coming in from DeLeon Springs. There's lots of hunting going on over there. Nicole, is it, or Nicole? Nicole. What's your question?
My question is the top 10 gamey, and if it is buttermilk the only way to take the gamey flavor out?
No, no. Trevor and I like buttermilk, you know, and we were talking before the show that you could actually use a brine solution. One I recommend, I don't know if this works for you, but I like to use brown sugar and salt and go ahead and marinate some of the product in that. Is there something you use?
Absolutely.
Especially?
I do kind of the same thing. Sometimes I'll put a little pepper and some hotter spices in with it as well, but pretty much that salt brine.
Oh, there you go. I like that.
Yeah.
I got to get this hen out of here before I burn it up. It's delicious. Y'all can't eat any. We're going to eat it. I think it's important that you get some of that marination into any of that product that you deal with. And I'm getting this out of here right now and turning this off. Okay, let me get something started here real quick so I can show you a little bit of something. Take a little bit of the swamp cabbage. We're not gonna do this chef style, but we're sort of, look at this, isn't this beautiful? You make a nice little meal out of it like this. And a little tiny drumstick. I can't get over these little tiny drumsticks. Look at that. Look at that plate. That's a nice looking plate. Actually, if you wanted to dress it up a little bit more, excuse me, Trevor, I'd get a little bit of parsley just for show. And then you kind of chop it up a little bit. One of those chef things. And I go bang, bang, bang all over it. Who's that guy that does that? Eat your heart out. He's not eating Martian, I guarantee you. Look at that. That's pretty nice, isn't
it? Looks
it?
Wonderful.
I don't know if you want to say that again, please.
Oh, looks wonderful.
Isn't that good? I thought you might want to chew on that a little bit. That's pretty good, isn't it? Now, I want to get rid of this pan I have here, and I have a duck breast here. A lot of people don't know how to cook duck breast. I'm going to show you real quick. It's not that hard. Get this real hot pan out of my way and put this pan up here. And of course, I'll get my magic ingredient. I like butter. And then we're also going to use a little bit of this oil. which is a canola and the olive oil blend. Put that in there. And I'm gonna save the magic ingredient till a little bit later, till we get this nice and hot. And we have our, how's your, okay?
It's awesome.
And that's pretty good, isn't it? So we gotta season this up. I love seasoning. This is the kind of seasoning I use. I don't know if you smell that or not. That's that smoked salt. I love that smoked salt and pepper. I'm gonna put that all over this duck breast here. Now, you know, a lot of people, what they do with duck breast, they pull the skin out from the bottom in here and they stuff it. They kind of pull it out like this. And guess what? They put butter inside. Oh my goodness. Or you can use spray butter if you want. All our people out there are complaining to me, says, just using too much. And you have to put it in a real nice hot pan, because what you want to do is make that skin real crispy on the outside.
Yeah, that's the best
part. So it looks like it's really smoking up, but it's not. Turn this down just a little bit. And that's what you do with your duck breast. You just get it going. You want some more? Did you get enough?
Oh. That's so never funny. Enough.
There you go. And see, if you look at it, this Cornish game hen is very similar to it. It's a little milder. Now, I made this also with the same ingredients that I used for the marsh hen. And this is one of the dishes I put together. I didn't give you a chance to taste this either. You might want to just taste that sauce on that. Oh man, that looks good. How's that taste?
Phenomenal.
And that pickling spice gets in there, it really, really adds to it real well. And anyway, so you can make almost like a casserole out of this. This is really a great dish, I love it. Okay, we're gonna turn this down some more. I'm gonna add a little bit more oil to it. Okay. This is gonna work real well. Don't forget our number is 1-800-901-9238. And I'm gonna hide this over here because I know there's some of these students afterward gonna say, is there any left? I'm gonna put this, that's a pretty plate, isn't it?
It's a pretty plate.
I really like that. Trevor, what do you do? Are you a professional outdoorsman? Is that what you do, or do you have something else that you do?
I do a little bit of everything. I own a marine electronics business, but I also I do fishing guiding and hunting guiding,
really?
As well.
Where at?
We do fishing guiding all down the East Coast, all the way to the Florida Keys, tarpon season, mostly fly fishing. And then hunting we do...
Fly fishing.
Correct.
Well, you just said the magic words. My wife's out there right now saying, fly fishing, find out. Hey, just if you're not listening, my wife and I love to fly fish. And when Trevor and I were talking about that, Trevor says he went to the same place in Georgia we went.
Yep. It's a small world.
It is a small world.
It is a small world.
It was amazing. I went up there fly fishing to this camp up there, and I was telling you the story. The lady asked me, says, are you a chef? I said, yeah, I'm a chef. She says, would you mind coming up to the house? And I was thinking that lodge there was her house. No, it was up on the hill, this beautiful brick. Oh, it was gorgeous. And she invited my wife in up there three different times to do a cooking seminar for her friends. So we used to go up there and go fishing for free. And the fish, you know what I'm talking about.
People
said fish was this big. Trout was this big. I couldn't believe it.
Big fish.
So we're going to put this right down here. What you do with your duck breast after you get it cooked down real well, you have to put it in the oven to finish it off. And it's okay for it to be kind of medium, little pink inside. It
Absolutely.
Doesn't hurt anything at all. But, you know, it's amazing to me when you do that. We were just talking about this induction stove. Trevor says, yeah, I've seen those before. He says, but that one's awfully fast. We talked about this in one of our last shows. People kept asking what the induction stove was. And it's battery operated, actually. The steel pan that I put here makes it start cooking. And when you take the pan off, it stops cooking. It's really amazing. It's energy efficient. I need your help on some electronics, so I've got some problems at home that you can help me with.
I'll be glad to.
Is there anything you want to share with people on hunting here in Florida?
Just that there are so many opportunities that I think most people overlook here in Florida. Everything from the clapperrail or the marsh hen to other waterfowl such as ducks, things like snipe. There's a lot of things to do out there that I think a lot of people are unaware of.
You know, one of my favorite was teal. I used to love to hunt teal.
Absolutely.
It's such a good tasting bird. We used to, oh gosh, I can't remember how often we used to do that.
And that's another one of the birds that you can actually hunt early. It's the first.
Oh, really?
We have an early teal season.
Well, I want to thank you for coming. I really do, Trevor. It's been very enjoyable for me to talk to a fellow hunter, actually. I don't hunt like I used to, but I really enjoy talking to people that do because they appreciate what we've been doing out there. Is there anything you want to leave us with?
Well, just thank you very much for having me. I really enjoyed myself today.
Okay, well, folks, we want to thank you for coming and joining us on Local Flavor. We're out of time. But viewers, don't forget now, you join us next week, okay? Go on Facebook and look at our recipes that we have here. Join us and look at Local Flavor. We're going to have different events going on each week. So come see us. Thank you very much for joining us tonight.